Today, we're going to look at my favourite puzzle. It's involving squares, rectangles. I've actually used this a few times in the Oxford University admissions interview questions, so it's got some heritage behind it, a bit of prestige behind this question. I won't be using it anymore, because I'm going to tell you all how it's done. We're going to start with a square, like so. And this can be any size square, doesn't really matter. And what we want to do is fill the square with rectangles. Now, the rectangles can be of any size as well, but they have a rule that they have to be in the ratio 2 to 1. So this doesn't mean this is length 2 and this is length 1. This could be length, let's say this was 2 quarters, and then, oh, I should have picked a better number, and this one needs to be 1 quarter. So we could have smaller ones, really tiny ones. It doesn't matter the size of the rectangle, they just have to be in this ratio. Long side is twice the length of the short side. And what we want to do is fill the square with these rectangles. And we're interested in, for what numbers of rectangles is it possible to fill the square? So clearly for one it isn't, because a rectangle in this ratio 2 to 1 is not a square, so you can't just fill it with 1. So we can say for n equals 1, that's a big no. But then for n equals 2, it's gonna work, because I can just do that. If we say the square is 1 by 1, then both of these rectangles are 1 by 1/2, twice in the ratio, and we can fill it with 2. So n equals 2 is a tick, and that was n equals 1, was the cross. And we want to know, for what other values can we do this? Is it possible for any other values? Can we do it for all of them? That's the question. Can we figure this out?
So you can use duplicates, obviously.
Yes, we can use the... So here we've got 2 of the same size. I could have... It doesn't have to all be the same size. So that's important. We could have 1 big one and, I don't know, 6 small ones or something, or maybe like 4 different size rectangles. There's no limit in the size of the specific rectangles or the numbers of each one. Just we're interested in the total number of rectangles that fill the square, as long as they're in this ratio.
So is the puzzle question, for which numbers can we do it? Or is the question, can you do it for all numbers, or like?
I always thought of it, or I always present it as, for which numbers can we do it? But within that, we're kind of saying, can we do it for all numbers? Are there some numbers other than 1 where it doesn't work? But we're going to hopefully, we're going to try and consider all possible values. That's the goal. We're going to actually try and consider every single number. So the way I would approach a problem like this is, well, there's 2 options, the way I see it. So we've shown so far it's not going to work for 1, because then it would be a square. And we've shown that we can do it for 2. So you could continue in this way and say, well, let's try and do it for 3. Let's try and do it for 4. But the problem is, if you hit a number where it doesn't work, you've got to show it doesn't work. You've got to like try everything. Like you have to exhaust all possible ways of arranging rectangles. And it's really difficult to exhaust every single possible thing that you can do in such an open problem like this. So my suggestion would be to think, well, can I find something else that works that isn't 2? Let's try and get like another handle on the problem and see if we can use that to build other cases. If we start with the 2 that we had a square and we divided it into 2. So if I now divide this bottom rectangle into 2 squares, I've now got a square that I can divide into 2 and another square that I can divide into 2. And lo and behold, we've got a solution. So we've got 5 there. N equals 5 is a tick. So we took what we had, which was 2, and then sort of broke it down. So I call this the breaking down method into one of them. We broke it up first into 2 squares and then copied what we did at the start to get 4. So we replaced 1 rectangle by 4 rectangles. So in total, we added 3 to our 2 that we started with. Now, there's nothing stopping me from doing this again and again and again. So I can pick one of my 5 rectangles, divide it into 2 squares, and then divide each square into 2 rectangles. And now I should have 8. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So now we get n equals 8 is a solution. And I could have, of course, picked another rectangle and divided that up. I could have picked the top one, and then I would have got a solution where we had 8 all of the same size. But remember, we're not interested in the specific configuration. We just care about the number of rectangles. Is it a tick or is it a cross? I can continue to do the same thing. So if I continue with this bottom left one, 2 squares, 2 rectangles. And I've replaced 1 rectangle by 4, so I've added 3, so that would be 11. and I can do the same again. So this is the last one I'll show you because I'm running out of space, and I can just continue this. And again, I don't have to keep picking this one. We can keep adding 3. So we get 14, we get 17, we get 20, 23. To come back to the original question for which, how many like ways can we do this? We now have an infinite number of ways to fill a square with these 2x1 rectangles because we just keep adding 3 and we can just go on forever. But we're missing quite a few. There's a lot of gaps. There's almost like twice as many gaps as there are numbers we're hitting because we're hitting every other third number. So what we want to try and do now is think about, well, how could we hit those numbers? This method I called the breaking down method because we took a solution that we had and then we broke down a rectangle and added 3 to the total. And then the other approach I'm calling the building up, because what we're going to do is again, start with our square and we want to now add rectangles around the outside, but so that the final shape is a square, because remember the square can be any size. So if we try and build up, you think about this a little bit, and again, you should do this, you can kind of create an overhang like this on all 4 sides. You can hopefully see that's possibly going to work. It could maybe be a square. So again, if we take the middle one to be 1 and this one to be 1/2, so the middle square was 1x1, then what we've got here is this length is 2, and then this one to be in the correct ratio has to be 1. So we do indeed have a square. We've got 2 different sizes of rectangle, 2 in the middle and then 4 of this second size, where the square that we fill in total is going to be 3 squared, but it's built up of 6 rectangles. So now we've got a different solution, 6. We didn't have before. And just like before, we can keep doing this and building up. So you could just do that. And you could figure out the numbers. These are going to be a bit bigger again, and you're going to keep doing this. And we keep adding 4 every time. So we've got 6, then we can say that we can do this now for 10. Then we add another 4 to get 14, 18, 22, 26, 30. So we have another infinite list possible solutions. And some of these numbers are the same. We've got 14 in both lists, but also, you know, we've got 10, which we didn't have. We've got 18, 22. We've got new numbers as well. So there's some overlap, but we've got another way of constructing these solutions. Like before, in this first case, we said that what we were doing was we were adding 3 every step. And you can think of this as saying, well, if I have a solution for n, for some number, then I know from our method here, the breaking down method, I can take one of the rectangles in the solution, divide it up into 4 smaller rectangles, and that added 3 to our solution. So if we had a solution for n, we can always get n plus 3 from the breaking down method. And then here, we've seen the same thing, because we started with 2 and I added 4 around the edge. But if I'd started with the 5 solution here, then I add 4 around the edge, and then I add another 4. So I can also get, for example, there, I would get n equals 9 plus 4 on that. So then I'd get 13, 17, 21, etc. And again, we're getting some numbers we didn't have. The breaking down method, if we can do it for n, we always get n plus 3, break one of them into 4 pieces. The building up method, if we can do it for n, we can always do it for n plus 4. And now these two are really powerful rules. So we've already seen that we've got a lot of solutions, but if we actually think about this mathematically now, using the algebra, we can begin to see that we actually get almost all of the numbers. So I think the best way to demonstrate this is sort of write out the list of the first 30 numbers and cross off the ones we can and can't do, and then we'll think about, can we prove this? So we know that 1 didn't work, and I think that's the only one we know that doesn't work. We showed that 2 did. We haven't looked at 3 or 4. We had 5. We had 6. We haven't covered 7 yet. I think we had 8. Yes, 8 was the 5 plus 3. 9 we got down here by doing 5 and then 4 around the outside. Then we had 10 on our list. Now, we've got something really helpful here because we've got 3 numbers in a row. So because I've got 8, I know that I can just add 3 to it and get 11. Because I've got 9, I can add 3 to it and get 12. Because I've got 10, I can add 3 to it and get 13. And then this is just going to carry on. So you can look back through our lists as well and see, you know, we had 14, 17, and you could tick them off. But if you spot that because we had these 3 numbers in a row, then, and we had this n plus 3 rule, we're actually going to get all of the other numbers. So there's lots of ways of spotting that you're going to get all the other numbers. But however you do it, it relied on the fact that we had, well, actually only really this rule, the n plus 3, once we'd figured out that we could get 8, 9, and 10. So we did need building up to get some of these, right? So 9 and 10 came from the building up method, and 8 came from the breaking down. So we did need the second method, but really we just needed the n plus 3 rule plus those three, and then we got all of the numbers. So that just leaves us with 3, 4, and 7. So we know that 1's impossible, we know that every single other number is possible now, except 3, 4, and 7. So we've got to figure these ones out. And you've got to do this case by case. I'm going to need more paper, aren't I?
I have no intuition as to whether 3, 4, or 7 are possible.
This is how I think about it. We're going to consider 3. We're going to say, right, let's try and find a solution for 3. Suppose we can do that. And you want to think about the number of corners in your square. 1, 2, 3, 4 corners. And we have 3 rectangles. For example, let's take one of our rectangles. Suppose it hits all 4 corners. It's clearly got to be a square, and there's clearly no space for the others. So you cannot have one of your rectangles hitting all 4 corners. Similarly, you cannot have one of your rectangles hitting 3 corners, because if one rectangle hits 3 corners, it kind of has to hit the 4th, and it kind of has to be a square again. So the highest number of corners a single rectangle can hit is 2. And in fact, one of them has to hit 2, because there's only 3 rectangles and 4 corners. So categorically, we can say one of the rectangles must cover 2 of the corners of our square. And so the only way to fit that is to divide it in half. If we're trying to find a solution for n equals 3, this is completely fixed. There's nothing else that can happen. So then we've got to fill the remaining space with 2 rectangles. So now we've got 2 rectangles and we've got 4 corners again. So okay, it's a rectangle instead of a square, but the corners is a really helpful way to get stuck into this problem because they've all got to be touched. So now you say, right, I obviously can't hit all 4 because then I'd fill it, it would work, but I've got one rectangle left. I can't hit 3 for the same reason, so I have to hit 2. And each of them has to hit 2. If we take a 1 by 1 square, this is a half, so this one has to be a quarter. It's the only way you can fill a rectangle fitting 2 corners. So then what we're left with, this has to be a rectangle. And if we figure it out, this is 3/4, this is a half. It's certainly a rectangle, but it's not in our ratio, 1 to 2. So that doesn't work. And so n equals 3 doesn't work. 3 is getting crossed out. Now 4, you do in basically the same way. Start with your square. You say you've got 4 corners. We've got 4 rectangles. Similar argument, one of them has to touch 2. Because if each one touches 1, you can play around with it a bit, but you'll see that it doesn't work. It kind of has to be 4 squared. It's the only way you can get it to work, and it doesn't fit our rules. So again, you have to have one of them like this, touching those 2 corners. So this is out. And then you're left now with 3 rectangles to fill this half. We've got 4 corners, 3 rectangles. Same argument as before, except now we're on a rectangle. We have to touch 2, so it has to be this one, half by a quarter again. And then we've got the same space. You can play around with this as much as you want. If you put one horizontally, it has to go the same size, a half and a quarter, and that's obviously a square. Or if you go vertically down, this won't work because this is a quarter and this one here is 3/4. That would be 1 to 3 ratio, not 1 to 2. So 4, for the same reason really as 3, ain't gonna work.
Cross it off.
So it all comes down to 7. This is the big finale of our infinite list of numbers for solving my favorite rectangle puzzle. Can we do it for n equals 7? And the answer, maybe surprisingly, is yes. We can do it. It is possible for 7. It's quite tricky. For those of you who really want to give this a go, this is the time. Have a go. It's very fun trying to do this. The trick with solving it for 7, or the way we do it, is we actually need 3 different size rectangles. We'll say this is a 1 by 1 square, so I can convince you all that this works. And it doesn't look like it's gonna work at first. So to start with, we have one big rectangle that's gonna be our 1/2 by 1. So you'll notice this is the building block of almost all of our ideas, actually. And then you have 3 little guys. So this is gonna have to be a 1/3 for each of them. And the height here to be in the ratio 1 to 2 is 1/6. We have another one here, and then we put another 2 here. This is a 1/3, that will be 1/6, and that will be a 1/2. So we can check 1/6, that will be 2/6, 3/6. So that's 1, that works. This bit here is 1/6, this one's 1/6. So that fits to be 1/3. And then this gap here, this top long side is 2/3 and this one's 1/3. And we're done. So we've got 5 of these small ones, 1 middle-sized one, and 1 big one. And that is the solution for n equals 7. N equals 7.
Yeah.
So we can solve it for all possible values of n. We can fill our square with n rectangles in this ratio 2 to 1, except for 1, 3, and 4.
All right. So now, anyone who watched this video can get into Oxford.
Yes, I used this question for the last 2 years, actually. So that's why I've had to retire it, because I tried to come up with new questions, but I like this one so much that actually this is the only question I've used on repeat, but it's now been retired. But yeah, this is the kind of thing, because there's lots going on. There's lots to think about, lots of things to check, and you could, if you wanted, go as fancy as you want in your proof with modular arithmetic or spotting the pattern. There's a lot to get stuck into.
Today's episode sponsor is Brilliant, and no matter who you are, they're going to have a course for you. I love how Brilliant are really upping their game on interactivity. That always helps with learning and understanding. What you're looking at now are just the opening exercises in their massive course on mathematical fundamentals. It's just great stuff. I love the style, that clean look. I also really like how everything unfolds at my pace, at the speed that I understand things. That's what the interactivity is all about. I never really think of Brilliant as being like school or study. It's more like a series of fun puzzles, but each puzzle is secretly giving you a deeper understanding of mathematics or science. To check this stuff out yourself, go to brilliant.org/numberphile. Using that /numberphile will tell them you came from here and also give you 20% off a premium subscription. brilliant.org/numberphile. It's well worth your time.
But, you know, the good students, the good candidates will be able to get through and spot the pattern with the adding of 3. And, like, that's the key thing, really, I think, in terms of the maths behind this, is spotting that pattern.